This morning, our scripture text is Psalm 85. And as I was looking for hymns that might help us to sing the sentiments of that psalm, I did find a hymn that that the text really fit that psalm. However, I didn't think you all would want to sing it. So during our prelude time, as you center yourselves to begin our worship, I would invite you to look at the words for hymn number 119, and as a bonus, it happens to be directly across the page from our opening hymn anyway. It's hymn number 119, Our God in Heaven, grant to thy children mercy and blessing, songs never ceasing.
Thank you. as we pray together the opening prayer found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Send your word, O Lord, like the rain falling down on the earth. We seek your endless grace with souls that hunger and thirst, sorrow and agonize. We would all be lost in darkness without your guiding light. When our lives suffer with adversities and hurts, send your healing power of love. We long for your new world. In the name of Christ our Redeemer, amen. Welcome again to St. John's. This week we have several activities going on. Those that are willing to admit they're 50 and above, they won't check IDs, but come out on Wednesday night for the game night. It's in Ward Hall at 6 o'clock. Bring a dish to share and join in the fellowship. There will be a cornhole tournament, so if you are, and also lots of games and fun activities. We will receive new members next Sunday. If you have been worshiping with us and want to know more about membership, ask Dr. Tim or myself after the service, or contact Midge Rothrock or Pam Green in the church office this week, and we'd love to see you next week. Back to school time is almost here. It's hard to believe, but we are collecting school supplies for children in Aiken County that are in need. So please prayerfully consider shopping for some school supplies or making a donation, and the church will provide items with your monies if you'd like to do it that way. Thank you so much. Together we stand as we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Gracious God, we thank you for all the ways that you have blessed us. We have been living in difficult times, and we know that you have seen our difficulties. Our flags around our country have been at half-mast more than at full because of all the death and destruction, heartache. Lord, we pray for your presence, especially as we are entering into a time of national discernment with one convention of one party having taken place and another to begin. We pray, O Lord, that you might give us wisdom and that we might reflect your values in our decision-making. But we are full well reminded that the hope for this country does not lie in one party or another, but relies upon our allegiance to you. So help us, Lord Jesus, to fulfill the word spoken that if we seek first the kingdom of God and your righteousness, then all that we need will be added unto us. Oh Lord, we pray for our community and the community of St. John's, and we pray for the witness of your people across the planet, that we might stand for justice, that we might support those who are being overwhelmed by violence. We pray for there to be peace on earth, but not peace where there is no peace, but true peace, a peace that is from the inside out. So, Lord, we pray for you to reign in our hearts today and bring us peace, a peace that is rooted and grounded and nourished by righteousness. Teach us, O Lord, and open our hearts that we might allow your Holy Spirit to work in and through us this day. Hear our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord as we pray together the prayer that he taught his disciples praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Lord.
And now let us continue to worship God by the giving and receiving of our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Remain standing as we sing our hymn of preparation, number 211, and our children are invited to follow the crucifer to Children's Church.
Please be seated. Psalm 85. For the director of music of the sons of Korah, a psalm. You showed favor to your land, O Lord. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people and covered all their sins. You set aside all your wrath and turned from your fierce anger. Restore us again, O God, our Savior, and put away your displeasure towards us. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger through all generations? Will you not revive us again so that your people may rejoice in you? Show us your unfailing love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. I will listen to what God the Lord will say, for he promises peace to his people, his saints, but let them not return to folly. Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before him and prepares the way for his steps. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. O come, thou Emmanuel. Not exactly a song to sing in the summertime in the heat as we're fanning our way through a long service. Well, hopefully not too long. But I must admit that sometimes I think these robes were meant for England and not at all for South Carolina. But indeed, this is a psalm and that asks for Emmanuel to come. Psalm 85 does that. You showed your favor to your land, O Lord. This is one of the few places where Yahweh's name is directly given to us. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. Usually we hear the name Israel as a name denoting God's people. Over 3,500 times, Israel is mentioned, but Jacob is only mentioned a couple of hundred. You forgave the iniquity of your people, covered all their sins. You set aside your wrath. You turned from your fierce anger. Restore us again. Revive us again, it says a little later, our Savior, O God. Show us your unfailing love. In Hebrew, that word for unfailing love is hesed. And if I pronounced it as a good Hebrew would, it would be, I can't even do it. Hesed. Unfailing love, unfailing grace. I will listen to what God the Lord will say. He promises peace to his people, his saints. Another word that is derived from that word, hesed, unfailing love, the hasadim, the saints. Do not let them return to folly. Surely let your salvation be near to those who fear him, that your glory may dwell in our land. And here we are on this Sunday in between political conventions. And I wonder if God's glory will dwell in our land. And then he says these beautiful words. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Kissing cousins. People who, as one person in our congregation would say, and did say to me, kissing cousins defined as those who are distant enough from us, yet close enough that we can get away with a kiss, but far enough away in relation to make it worthwhile. Or like the little boy in kindergarten who said to a little girl in kindergarten, they were both somewhere around 6 years of age, and the little boy said to the little girl, I want to marry you. And she said, oh no, that's not possible. In my family, we only marry kin. And the little boy said, what do you mean you only marry kin? She said, well, my mother married my father, my grandmother married my grandfather, and all my aunts married all my uncles. We only marry kin in my family. Two of my great-grandfathers had the same middle name because of their semi-close relation. One of our great-grandfathers was named Freeman Bird Thomas, and another great-grandfather was named Daniel Bird McClendon. And it shouldn't be a surprise that every summer we went to the Bird reunion. We think of kissing cousins as those persons who are related but not so closely related that they're doing something unseemly or unwise or undignified or even sinful by kissing. But it says in this passage of Scripture, love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. That love, hesed, produces faithfulness. Love should produce faithfulness. If we don't love another so deeply that it doesn't produce faithfulness, then you can call into question whether or not it's love to begin with. And the way to produce peace in our lives, or peace in our land, or for God's glory to dwell in our land, is for us to have righteousness. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. They should be closer than kissing cousins. I'm not only related to myself, can have a reunion by myself, but there's another in our sanctuary today who is her own half-second cousin once removed, because her great-grandmother on her mother's side was her great-great-grandmother on her father's side. Now, some of us have a family tree with lots of branches, but there are others like myself and my wife and maybe a few others of you who are like British royalty. We're so closely kin that we don't have a family tree, we have a family wreath. Or have land that's so good that you want to keep it in the family or not. Psalm 85 instructs us that if we want to have peace, both personal peace and corporate peace as a nation, even as a world, we must have righteousness. The Scriptures also tell us that that righteousness is something that we ourselves get to choose to do, but it also is something that is a gift from God. It's a gift of God, but it is something that we must yield to and do. Let me put it this way, in the words of the chaplain of the United States Senate. He said, if you listen to those who analyze the state of our nation today, historians, business leaders, ministers, people from all walks of life, they are saying that this corruption, this unrighteousness is eating away at the very fabric of our society, tearing down our institutions and destroying people's lives. National righteousness is sorely needed. I don't think anyone would disagree with that, but national righteousness is built on individual righteousness. It's built on those individuals who see what is right and who make a commitment to do what is right before God and before their fellow human beings. Individual righteousness is only produced in us when we enter into a state of communion and fellowship and obedience to God. A state of communion and fellowship and obedience to God. A right relationship with God produces righteousness within us. Indeed, national righteousness is built upon individual righteousness. Sometimes I think that rather than having individual righteousness and thereby not having national righteousness, we have given into something that one author has called self-swindling. You know, when we swindle people, we trick them, we cheat them. And very often in our lives and the moral choices that we make, because we have the freedom and right to do so, we have indulged in self-swindling. What a powerful phrase, self-swindling. Psychiatrist Carl Menninger, in his famous book, Whatever Became of Sin? That was published in 1973, but is still timeless, as it's quoted by another minister, Dr. Donald Strobe, talking about that book, Whatever Became of Sin, by Dr. Carl Menninger, he notes that American presidents used to mention sin once in a while. And I want you to pay attention and think back on the Republican convention and think forward to the Democratic convention. He says that American presidents, and I dare say candidates for president, used to mention sin once in a while, but that none has done so since 1953. Interesting. The Republicans refer to the problems of pride and self-righteousness. The Democrats refer to their problems of shortcomings. But none use the grand old sweeping concept of sin anymore. Thus, it seems, we as a nation stopped sinning 35 years ago. And speaking of politics, a poll on heaven and hell in the Des Moines, Iowa newspaper named The Register, that poll found that only one Republican in 35 expects to end up in hell, whereas one Democrat in 9 assumes that he or she will end up in hell. I'm not sure what that means, the author writes. It may mean that it does little good to preach hellfire and brimstone to a congregation that is filled with people who don't believe there is a chance in hell that they will end up there. Gosh, even Mason and Dixon had to draw the line somewhere. But we don't draw the line. And we have a problem with righteousness and peace kissing each other. And our lack of corporate, national, political, and individual righteousness has caused us to go into a pit. A pit of despond and despair. If our greatest need had been information, God would have sent us more educators, and I'm grateful for all the educators. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us more economists to help us make sure that we kept prosperous. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have given us more scientists. If our greatest need had been more pleasure, God would have provided more entertainers. But no, God knows that our greatest need is salvation, and so God gave us a Savior. We cannot turn to our political parties to deliver us. We cannot turn to our spouses to deliver us, although we do it on a regular basis. We cannot turn to our neighbors. We need to turn to God. If we truly believe that, we might just have revival. Because what America needs, what this world needs, is people that will come before God Almighty and say, I have sinned. I have fallen short of your glory. I need your help. I cannot help myself. I don't know who to vote for. If I vote for that one, I've got this problem. If I vote for that one, I've got this problem. So God, I vote for you. God, I vote for you. So many of us have failed in our endeavors to be righteous, to do well. We're very much like the popular prayer that goes like this: so far today, God, I've done all right. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper. I haven't been greedy or nasty or selfish. I haven't been overindulgent or told anyone to mind their own business and not mind mine. I'm really glad about all this, God, but in a few minutes I'm going to get out of bed and I'm going to need your help the rest of the day. In Jesus' name, amen. So how do we have righteousness if we pray that prayer and nothing good comes from it? The only righteousness that we can have, the only salvation that we can have, the only hope that we can have for our country and for our society, for our world and for civilization is through Jesus Christ. If we don't believe that, then we're lost. Not just without a moral compass for our country, but without a Savior for our lives. Without a way for us to be able to repent and start afresh. Without Jesus dying for us on that cross that we counted last week, as we counted, what was it, 6,559 crosses in this sanctuary, not at all even counting the crosses on the pew cushions, which would have been in the thousands. But without the cross of Jesus, we would be lost. So someone needs to tell us the gospel. The book of Romans speaks beautifully about the gospel and those who tell it. In Romans chapter 11, blessed are the feet of good news. Blessed are the feet of those who preach good news. I've had Billy Graham on my mind this week, still alive. I hope he doesn't die this week. He's a great man. I thought about him somewhat because of the political conventions, because he has been sort of a kind of pastor to the presidents or candidates or whomever. He's offered spiritual advice. But he's on my mind this week, I think, because I need a Savior. It was in March of 1971 that I was sitting on the edge of my bed in front of a little black and white television. And yes, I'd grown up in the church, had been confirmed in the church. But that night I felt my heart strangely warmed as Billy Graham on television offered the good news, the gospel. Blessed are those whose feet bring the good news. And I heard the good news with a clarity of thought and with the power of the Holy Spirit. And I said, Lord Jesus, I prayed that prayer along with Billy Graham. And I prayed, Lord, please come into my life. Now, part of the reason was because a few months before, we had had an uncle to die. And everybody who'd ever died in our family pretty much always got a generic funeral. You could just plug in a different name. But when that particular wife, one of several, asked a minister of another denomination to preach at this particular uncle's funeral, he preached on adultery, and so we knew which one it was. And I loved him. We all did. So when that Billy Graham crusade came along, I didn't want those question marks about my eternal destination, so I prayed. And then I went off to seminary after going to college. I went to seminary on the North Shore of Boston. And Billy Graham happened to be there to offer an address. And I wanted to introduce myself. I wanted to say thank you for the difference you made in my life. I cannot remember ever not believing in Jesus, but that night, in March of 1971, I felt God's peace and grace like I had never felt before, and it changed me. Righteousness and peace kissed each other, and it changed me. So I went up to him, and I introduced myself, and he stood up. And I don't know how many of you have ever met Billy Graham personally, but he is a very tall person. I mean, when he got up, he just kind of unfolded like an accordion, and he just kept going. And I said, I'm Tim McClendon. And he said, where are you from? And I said, Edgefield, South Carolina. And he said, I preached one of my first revivals in Edgefield, South Carolina, and I'm preaching the same gospel today as I did then. You go do the same. Wow. In 1988 or 89, our youngest child, we took a group to Williams-Brice Stadium for a Billy Graham crusade, and he preached it, but there was lightning in the distance. And so he said, I'm going to make this brief. If you need Jesus in your life, I want you to come down and pray. I was ready to go to the car. It was going to rain. But our little boy said, I want to go down. I need Jesus. And so we went down. You know, it's interesting being at Williams-Brice Stadium when that occurred. But I don't know if you know that a lot of Billy Graham's ministry to the world began in South Carolina. Sure, he was born in Charlotte. He was raised as an associate Reformed Presbyterian. Became a Baptist along the way. Married a Presbyterian. Tried it all but Methodism, but in many ways I think he would have been a best Methodist of all. But in 1950, about 8 months after he sort of sprung on the national scene, in 1950, he came to Columbia, and for 2 weeks they met in Township Auditorium, which is on Taylor Street in Columbia, those of you who know it. And it's not very big, but they packed it out. And so they decided on March the 12th of 1950 to go to the University of South Carolina's football stadium, which held at that time a grand total of 33,000 people. And 45,000 showed up. And the highway patrol had to send 10,000 or so on their way. And hundreds, some would say thousands, came to know Christ. Then Governor J. Strom Thurmond, native of Edgefield and of Aiken, was there. And his first wife, Jean Crouch, who's buried in Old Bethel Cemetery, last gravesite on the right as you're going north toward Edgefield. And after he finished preaching at the football stadium, guess where he went? Probably had something to do with Strom. Those of you who say Strom, you just don't know him or didn't know him, because it's Strom as in a guitar. You strum a guitar. That's the real deal. But he went to Edgefield, to Strom's home church, a First Baptist church, where recently we buried a first cousin. It's said to be able to hold 1,000 people. But they'd have to be small and thin. And if I'd known then what I know today after studying this week, I mean, I'd never heard it except for Strom saying that offhand remark. I preached one of my first revivals in Edgefield, and I'm preaching the same gospel today as I preached then. You need to preach it too. 5,000 people showed up to that 1,000-seat First Baptist Church in Edgefield. And they say over half of Edgefield County became Christian. Well, that tells me it didn't take for a lot. And then he went to Augusta, to Bell Auditorium, and preached there. And the rest, shall we say, is history. The rest, shall we say, is history. But all he ever said, and all he's ever said, is, would you like Jesus in your life? Would you like to be forgiven of your sins? Would you like Jesus to be your Savior? Would you like Him to be your Lord? Would you like righteousness? I'll ask you this. Would you like righteousness and peace to kiss each other in your life? Would you like peace and righteousness in our land so that God's glory will fill it? Then we won't be able to do it through political parties. We can do it through revival. And so how I'm going to close today is this. Do you want to believe in Jesus and know that you do? He will save you, change you. He will bless your life beyond belief. If that's something that you would like, If that's something that you would like, then we're not going to sing Savior again to thy dear name. We're going to sing number 357. It's a song that I know you've heard before, and I know that I've responded to before. Just as I am, without one plea. And I want to invite you, if you feel the need, the call of God and His gospel, if you feel the need for Jesus to be your Lord and your Savior, your Redeemer, then I'm going to invite you to do what Billy Graham always did. I'm going to invite you to come down. Jesus said in Matthew's gospel that if you acknowledge me before men, I will acknowledge you before my Father in heaven. Now, I could get you to do like Billy Graham said and close your eyes and bow your heads and every eye closed. But no. This is a day for public testimony. Is Jesus your Savior? If you want Him to be, you can stay where you're standing or seated, or you can come to this altar and we will have a prayer. But let's stand and come as the Lord leads you. For every person standing, those who've knelt at the altar and those who've knelt at the altar of their heart, we pray, O Lord, that you might restore unto us our salvation, that you might indeed bring your glory to our land and to every land. O Lord, help righteousness and peace to kiss each other in our lives. Change us. We pray, O Lord, come into our hearts. Be our Savior. Come into our lives and be our King. Sit upon the throne. Forgive us, we pray. O Lord, fan in the flames that have been felt today. And may your Holy Spirit roam freely among us. Just as Billy Graham came to Columbia, Augusta, Edgefield, Aiken, O Lord, let him be here again. Not Billy Graham, but the Holy Spirit. The gospel. We receive it. Give us joy. Amen. And now may the peace of God that passes all understanding guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.